3, 2, 1. You are live, you are live.
And as I said, a very good afternoon to all of you and welcome on our sunset safari, where I have just seen my first buffalo in several days. And he doesn't seem to want to see us though. In fact, he is quite determined to move off, I think just because there is some really nice shade over there. But he doesn't seem terribly impressed by us. Afternoon to all of you, and welcome to the Sunset Safari once again. My name is Jamie, and this afternoon I have Jandre on camera with me, and we had a buffalo, but he's gone now. You are on a live safari from the middle of a place called Juma Private Game Reserve, which is in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. So right up in the top northeastern corner, where the animals roam free and wild, as they have done for many, many generations. Let me duck my head out of the way so that you can see some of the newest arrival on Juma Private Game Reserve in the form of 3 adorable little impala lambs. I can see 2. Is that one lying at the... It is. Have you spotted the third? There's a question. I can see it. I can see the third little impala baby. Now, they are one of our absolute favorite things about this time of year. The other is the trilling call of the woodland kingfisher. The return of many of our beautiful species. The birth of the wildebeest calves. All in all, it is just a lovely time of year. It is, however, quite a hot time of year. I've forgotten what the temperature is. 38? 30, 37? It's 99. I know it's 99 in Fahrenheit. It is blisteringly warm. I promise you it is hotter than 99 in Fahrenheit when you're sitting here. We're all a little bit shiny at the moment, enjoying the baking hot temperatures, but it looks as though it might be another normal summer's day. Normal summer rain patterns coming back once again. Oof, that sky. Now, good afternoon to CE on our warm afternoon. I wanted to show you our buffalo, but unfortunately he has vanished. Now, you want to know, are buffalo herds and elephant herds gone essentially for the rest of the season, so the rainy season or summer? No, they will be back. We just won't see them in the massive numbers that we were seeing them during the dry season. So one of the big things that happens when it starts to rain, the gabbro soils start to give rise to these amazing grasslands, and there's quite a few of them in the northern side of Buffleshoek, Manyaleti, eastern side of Torchwood. So that's where a lot of our elephants and our buffalo have disappeared. Because you're right, I mean, it did seem as though we went from teeming with buffalo and elephants to having none. Now, just quickly before I carry on, I forgot to tell you that we are interactive as well, which means you can send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And if you are new to these safaris, it is not just myself out here. There is another gentleman called Byron. Let's... There goes our buffalo. The most contrary buffalo bull in all of Juma. Yes, my boy, I'm talking to you. Let me try that again. It's not just ourselves out here, there is also a gentleman called Byron. Let's go over to him to find out what his plans are for this afternoon.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. My name is Byron, and on camera with me this afternoon is Viam. And it is a very, very warm afternoon, so I'm thinking we are just going to start checking some water holes and see if we don't have any luck around there. No sign of Karula this morning. We had tracks on the bushwalk, we had tracks early on, but they basically headed directly in front of Vuyatela, so in front of the lodge, so she may still be in that area, but around those thick drainage lines. I may just head into that area a little bit later and go have a look and see if she doesn't pop out. But for now, two little Dacre. Off they go. Very quick little glimpse of them. Little Dacre, a beautiful antelope. One of the smallest we get in the area, that and the Steenbok. It's nice to see them, a pair of them. But they're very, very shy. That's usually how a Dacre sighting goes. They do run off quite quickly. Would be wonderful to find some elephant. And I'm hoping maybe we get the odd elephant coming through drinking water somewhere today. Oh, where's some warthogs drinking? Hang on, I thought I saw something interesting. What bird was that? Just have a look here quickly. You know what it was, everyone? It was the European bee eaters that are flying around. I can just hear them. I want to see if one or two land, perhaps, that I can show you. I know Jamie saw some this morning. I did hear about that, but they're wonderful to see a lot of them flying around here at the moment. It's very tricky. I thought I saw one go into this marula off to the left. Let's have a look. Can hear them calling too. They don't sit still usually, unfortunately. They do move away quite quickly. Some impala off to our left. See if there are any lambs around them. And this looks like a bachelor herd, perhaps. I think just some males. There it goes. Now these drainage lines, it's amazing. And there's a beautiful kudu. Hang on. I should get a nice view of it. Now these drainage lines are lovely areas because they are very cool and probably the coolest areas this time of day in this area. Look at that beautiful female kudu. These three male impala just walking past her. That's strange to see a female kudu by herself. Usually they're in small groups. I'm just scanning around to see if I can't see the others. Don't see any at the moment. And just the three males. That's also a small bachelor herd. Usually you can get a lot more males hanging around together. And as I was saying, with it being so hot, these animals do all head towards the drainage lines and they feed in these areas. It is a lot cooler, so it's a nice little area for them to hang around in until it starts cooling down again, and then they'll probably head towards water, have a drink, and then we know generally a lot of these animals, mainly the impala, not necessarily the kudu, they do enjoy the thickets, but the impala will head out towards the clearings or slightly more open areas and spend the night there where it's a bit easier to keep an eye out for predators. But for now, in this weather, this heat, it's nice just to stay close to the drainage lines and in the shade. Now I can still hear these European bee eaters flying above us. I don't know if you can pick up on their call, but let me play it for you quickly just to give you an idea. Let me just see, here we go, here it is. And I always think they're going to indicate rain, and I'll tell you why I say that, but listen to the call. Beautiful sound. And you can hear them flying above us at the moment, I can't see any. It's funny. Once you recognize the call of a bird, you can hear it very easily, but to find them sometimes is not easy. And they'll be flying about quite high up and calling. And they usually do that. Always, judging by what I've seen in the past, they usually do it when it starts getting cloudy and there's possibly a chance of rain, changing humidity in the air. And you can see it starting to cloud over behind us. So I wonder if perhaps this evening we don't have some bad weather coming in. But I'm not a weather expert and I don't know. Sometimes the birds get it wrong. Anyway, we're going to continue checking these drainage lines and having a look for animals down here and around water holes. While I do that, I'm not the only one out here. Neither is Jamie. We also have Brent, who's on the bushwalk. Let's go say hi.
Well, a bushwalk, more of a sauna. It is incredibly hot today. Welcome, and as you can see, I'm doing what all sensible animals in this heat does. I'm sitting in the shade of a beautiful tree. But on my way towards this beautiful tree, we did actually find what is probably a Natal Franklin, just judging by the size, its egg. Now, of course, we've just coming out of the drought, and we've talked a lot about the mammals and their problems they're facing, but birds also face problems. We're going to get into that in a second, because, of course, this time, it's the killer bees on foot.
Killer bees!
And yes, it's the deathly thumb for the deathly heat, unless you're as tough as the killer bees, because we will face the heat on foot, we shall. Now, while we were walking, we also found a little bit of a surprise. And I thought, where am I going to put the surprise without losing them? So I popped them inside. Look at that. Now, how's that look there? Can you see them?
Yeah.
Or should I take them out and put them in my hand?
Take them out and put them in your
hand. Put them out and put my hand. So very, very pretty. I'm just going to get them into a spot where Brian can get them really nicely. So there we go. Those are lucky beans, and they're from the lucky bean creeper. So there we go. I could not find the creeper. Aubrey, who's making sure we're safe, found those lying on the ground nearby. But isn't that absolutely beautiful? Now, if I were to throw them back, I'd be in hospital. So they are quite poisonous, but they're used traditionally as decorations and bracelets and things like that, and on clothing. But I think I'm going to keep it. Oh, no, come back. One lucky bee nearly escaped. But as I was saying about the birds, also face quite a bit of a troubled time during the drought, especially something like a Franklin that eats a lot of grass as well as eating insects. So drought, insects and grass are not something that are plentiful. But this Franklin has obviously done well. So what you often find after extreme droughts, extreme floods, etc., there's certain things, and specifically in certain animals, you can notice. Now, with birds, when they breed, one of their biggest problems is the thickness of their shell. So if the shell's not thick enough, most of the time those little baby birds will not survive. But this is impressive. I mean, this is well built, and incredibly how thick it is. Now, I can tell it's definitely a bird's egg from the way it's made. It's more ceramic type sort of than a reptile's egg, which would be sort of leathery, and I'll be able to push it and squash it. But there we go. Very, very cool. I think I'm going to keep this because it's not often you find one as nice as and intact as that. Now, there's a very specific reason I chose this beautiful big jackalberry that's here. And Aubrey and I were chatting with Brian as we walked across towards this little dry riverbed, and this is of course where Karula had the kill very recently, and we only had tracks of Karula disappearing this morning, so we think young Shungile and Hosana might be there. Now, Brian, do you think I'll make the hill?
Maybe.
Maybe. Is death defying?
Ooh, very much so.
Oh, it's killer bees. Here we go. Whoa! And I get to have a snack. No, I don't. So this is really, really rotten already. I'm not touching this. I'm touching the fur on the outside. But that's all that's left of the young impala. Now, strange enough, those of you who've been watching will remember a leopard, a big favorite of mine, whose name was Kunyuma. And this is a kill of a bushbuck, if I remember correctly. It could have been an inyala that Kunyuma had in this exact tree. So it's incredible that, I mean, nearly 2 years later, Mom's brought the next generation to the exact same tree, and she probably brought Kunyuma to this tree many, many moons ago. But very, very cool. So the reason I'm down here and Brian's up there is, of course, we don't want to have any gremlins. But isn't that cool? So that's definitely the second generation of Karula's cubs we know for sure that have been to this exact beautiful old African ebony tree. But moving on, Jamie's got something that might fly away, so let's go have a look.
And just have a look at this, one of my absolute top five favorite raptors, a harrier hawk or a gymnogene. And the presence of this particular bird has well and truly upset the apple cart. Have a look at the color of his face, because that's going to disappear soon. That's not just because of the heat, that is because he has been dive bombed repeatedly by a bird known as a fork-tailed drongo. He's also been mobbed by the various starlings of the area, and for very good reason. So usually a harrier hawk's... Oh, he's so cross. Usually harrier hawks, when they are nice and relaxed, have yellow faces, but he's flushed and red because he's angry. He's being attacked by other birds. And they have a jolly good reason to do so, because this is a very proficient nest raider. This is a bird that we don't often get to see, and the fact that this one is being as obliging as it is truly amazing. Oh, look at it snapping at the starlings. I don't know where the drongo's gone, but the drongo was being incredible. It was dive bombing backwards and forwards, dropping out of the sky and flying at this harrier hawk. Oh, there comes more starlings. They're so unimpressed. But a harrier hawk is a serious, serious threat to their nests. So harrier hawks, with their double-jointed legs and their ability to turn themselves completely upside down at times, will go forward and spend its day digging its talons into holes in trees and various bird nests, where they lay their eggies. It will reach in and grab the eggs or grab the chicks. Though it is not a very popular bird. In fact, it is probably the most unpopular of all of the raptor species. And the starling's not quite... I take that back. I was about to say not quite as brave as the drongos. Isn't it amazing, the courage of these birds? Incoming! Oh, false alarm. No, incoming! Again, false alarm. It's amazing, these little birds, the courage that they have to face off against a bird of prey that is so much larger than themselves. And when we came through, he was on the floor, or she was on the floor, gotta be careful of doing that. I'm not quite sure, or on the ground. The floor is in a house, on the ground. And I'm not quite sure what it was up to. It was obviously disrupted by the starlings. Look at the color slowly draining from its face. Well, since I'm here, might as well have a look and see if there's any holes in the tree. They are the most incredible birds to watch. Andre and myself once spent... How long did we spend with that one on quarantine? An hour. It must have been close to an hour. And eventually, we saw it catch what was either a baby squirrel or a bush baby. We still, to this day, don't really know. But it happened so fast. Luckily, Jandre managed to catch it on camera, because he's just good that way. Well done, Jandre.
I try.
I'm waiting to see what this harrier hawk... They don't usually stick around this long, and I'm actually surprised that it has. I wonder if it's not waiting to go back to... for the starlings to get bored, so that it can go back to where it was on the ground. And apologies to Cuddly Owl. I don't think I did say it clearly enough. I got so excited that I forgot to really go into the name properly. It is a harrier hawk, an African harrier hawk. Also, the old name is a gymnogene, which I have to say is kind of cooler than harrier hawk. The name gymnogene just has a certain ring to it that harrier hawk does not. Harrier hawk, of course, is the official name because it is far better descriptive in terms of the bird's evolutionary background and its family background. Gymnogene, I'm actually not sure where the name gymnogene comes from, but I like it better. It's also because I've been raised knowing it as a gymnogene. You can see the crest on the top of its head. They are grey birds with barring underneath their chest. So the only bird that you could maybe mistake a harrier hawk for is a is one of the members of the goshawk family. Perhaps maybe the dark chanting goshawk, but they're much, much larger than those birds. And they have a very different approach, a very different way of moving on the logs and on the trees, a very different posture. They also, of course, provoke a far more intense reaction from surrounding birds. Although it seems as though this one's decided to settle now. You know what? It's hot. I don't think it wants to fly because it's hot. Look, it's panting. It's the only, one of the only ways that birds can cool down. And enlightened guru, you want to know whether or not they eat other birds. Yes, they are nest raiders, so they will eat chicks. They don't tend not to be able to catch adult birds, although they could if there was perhaps some hapless female sitting on her eggs or sitting with her chicks in the nest, then they could catch her and they could eat her. But yes, they are nest raiders. So hot. I've never seen one sit still for this long. Panting away. Was panting. Yep, there it goes again. One of the only other ways that birds can cool, or one of the few ways that birds can cool down, because of course they can't sweat. A lot of the storks out here that spend a lot of their day in the blazing sun in the water, not in the water, that will cool them down, but away from the water, things like marabou storks will actually defecate on their legs to help to cool themselves down. But for the harrier hawk, that isn't really an option, and its legs aren't really long enough for that to make much of a difference. So panting is... Oh, back again. One parting shot from the final starling. Wait, somebody's coming in. Kingfisher! You know what? It really sucks being the harrier hawk of the bush. Everybody hates you. Even if you're just sitting there minding your own business, panting away, everybody just wants to bite your head off. I'm trying to think of a human equivalent. Shame. You know, when you're just sitting there minding... Look, I mean, admittedly, they are a big threat to birds' nests, so you can't blame the birds. I mean, even when they are just sitting there, even a kingfisher, that was a brown hooded kingfisher, by the way, that shot past and nearly picked it on the head. And now, what their birds are actually doing is just keeping a very close eye on what this harrier hawk is up to. They always have such a hard done-by look about them as well, that hunched posture. I suppose I would too, if everybody kept pecking me. Now, of all things flighted, Brent perhaps is seriously fascinated by butterflies. Let's go and see which particular one he has found.
Of course, as you go to a butterfly, it flutters by. Now, it's going to probably land... There we go, out in the open again. You got him, Brian? Now, that is one of our more common species. We had a couple around here, but it's the only one who's hung around to say hi. And you can see the black coming through at the sort of back end of the wing. And this is a broad-banded grass yellow. One of our most common yellow... Oh, flutter, flutter, flutter by. One of our most common yellow butterflies. And at the moment, they're feeding on a very, very yellow little flower. I'm just going to get one for you here. And this one, the reason I've picked this one is most of them have already pollinated and fallen off. It is called a yellow justicia. And it is a... It's named, well, actually a village very close by here is named after this. We get about five or six different justicias, this being the most common. And now let me teach you a little bit about the scientific name of things. So justicia is... I think it's actually from a British plant originally, but the second part, flava. Flava, if I remember my Latin or ancient Greek, is yellow. So there we go. It's a yellow justicia, and it tells you that in the Latin name. Very, very cool. Very common around sort of disturbed soils, and a really great spot to look for butterflies, especially the blues. And they're the tiniest, most hard ones to identify. And I'm really hoping, and with Brian's steady camera work, that the killer bees are going to find you a blue or two today. Now, I just wanted to have a look. So The reason we had quite a few butterflies. Ooh, I don't know what that is, Brian. Oh, it's a jumping spider. Okay, I don't want to get too close because he'll leap away. So if you see that sort of patch of dead stuff, right in the thickest middle, there's a little black and white jumping spider. You got him, yeah. Now look at these guys, are incredible. Did he just jump? Terrible creature. Okay, I'm gonna try to get a bit closer, see if he jumps into view. Oh no, he's still there. If we come. Now, this is more delicate than tracking a leopard. It's called tracking a jumping spider, because they can leap. So we've tracked it. Now, I just saw a glimmer of movement. Yeah. Have you got him there?
Yeah.
Okay, we don't want to get too close just yet in case he decides to gap it. What stick is he on? Yeah. Oh, he's on the grass. Look at that. Isn't that beautiful? Now, imagine that. If that thing was the size of an impala, an elephant wouldn't be safe. They are incredibly strong. And if he was the size of an impala, he could probably jump 100 feet in a single leap. Now, you've got lots of different types of jumping spiders, but most of them are ambush spiders. They can spin silk like all spiders, but they don't rely on webs to catch their prey. Well, there we go. See that? That's why he's called a jumping spider. He's jumped out of frame. He's running along there now. But he's... I'm trying to remember, my spiders are a bit rusty, but the black and one like this, I think if I remember correctly, is called a harlequin jumping spider. Which one would make sense, you know, black and white? Well, he's actually come closer to us. He's become acclimatized to the killer bees. Now, of course, little creatures like this that can move so quickly are incredibly difficult to film, and that's why I'm thankful to have my partner in crime, Brian, on foot with me today as we explore the little creatures, and we think we might find a leopard as well, but don't tell anyone else of Juma. But Byron's got another bird, so let's go have a look.
Oh, now look at this, everyone. We've got a cuckoo, but I wonder... Now, I'm going to explain a few things to you, because it looks to me like this could potentially be a common cuckoo, which is actually not very common, surprisingly, despite the name. And I'll tell you why. It looks so similar to the African cuckoo. But this one, so if you look at that beak, it's a little bit darker, almost black to the tip. And then at the base of the beak, at the back, it's got yellow. Whereas the African cuckoo has got, I'd say, a bit more of an orange bill or beak. But they do look so similar. Although, I'm trying to make sure, because it's just these cuckoos are quite rare at the best of times. You don't often see them. But the interesting thing with the common cuckoo is it's silent in Southern Africa. It doesn't call. So if this bird calls, then we know it is an African cuckoo. But I'll show you how similar they are shortly. Just try and get a good look at it. You can see it's very, very hot. Opening its beak and trying to cool down. Yeah. So difficult. And the other thing is, obviously, to find a decent picture of one is very difficult. No, you know what? Now, there's definitely a lot more orange on the African cuckoo and a yellowish eye, where the common cuckoo has got a bit more of a yellowish color around the eye and a much darker beak. I think this is a common cuckoo. And those of you who can get screenshots and have a good look and try identify it, but I do think this is a common cuckoo. That is wonderful. I think this is wonderful. All right. Now, I'll show you why I say that. Okay, let's have a look at the common cuckoo first. So, this is what I think it is. Now, unfortunately, this app can't zoom in any closer. But you can see, and there's another picture here, the darker color around the beak, the slightly yellowish base, and the yellow around the eye, that slightly yellowish color around the eye. I think this is a hepatic form. Yeah, that's a hepatic form. We don't often see those. And then the adult, that's the adult, and that was the barring we could see. Unfortunately, just not a front-on view of it. But then let me show you the African cuckoo quickly. And the African cuckoo here, you can see far more orange in the beak, or orange and orange around the eye, just a black tip to the beak. And that definitely did not look like it. That bird had more black and then a bit of a yellow base. That was it. But full adult coloration of the common cuckoo, not this African cuckoo. So I do think, and it hasn't called. I'm trying to listen out just to hear, because the African cuckoo call is very easy to identify. It's like a boop, 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 boop. Sorry, something like that, but very easy to identify, and I haven't heard it call. And like I said, the common cuckoo is silent in southern Africa, which is very interesting. And why I'm so excited is because I've never seen the common cuckoo before, so it'll be a lifer for me. I'm not just trying to convince myself that it is a common cuckoo. I do really think that was, and I wonder, is it still sitting there? It is still sitting there. That is incredible. Wow, that is fantastic. But that is such a nice sighting of a cuckoo. Usually they fly away very quickly, as you know and as you've seen. But that was really, really interesting. So I do think that's a common cuckoo, which I'm very excited about. Lovely to see new birds. I'm going to just browse through my app and read a bit more about the common cuckoo and see what else I can find out. While I do that, let's cross over to Jamie, who's finally got some tall animals for us to see.
Well, hopefully we are all back and up and running. I'm sorry for the extended period of silence. We were having some problems with our stream, I think. So Rebecca had asked me to, in no uncertain terms, to just please be quiet whilst they attempted to fix things. Though, so as you may or may not have gathered, I'm not sure whether you were paying any attention, we are with some giraffe, a surprise. And of course now they've decided to all but disappear into the bush. But we actually have, I mean, it's a relatively rare sighting for us to see 7 giraffe in an area like this. It's actually 7 males, quite possibly the same 7 males that we have seen in the past. I know Taylor saw them play fighting, or necking as it's known, and it may well be them. But yes, a journey of 7 male giraffe, which is a nice surprise because it feels like a long time since I last saw a giraffe on these live safaris. I don't know whether Brent, Byron or James have had any more luck than I have, but it does feel like quite an extended period since we've enjoyed a pleasant giraffe sighting. And since they've all now decided, wait, hold on, here comes one, he's going to come into the open, and then I'll reposition for him. It's a young male, still hasn't reached his full size, very light in colour. His ossicones not yet fully developed. Though there's about, from what I can see, what I saw briefly, there's about 3 or 4 young males and then a couple of big dominant or almost dominant bulls. They seem to be the ones hanging out a little bit further to the back. Oh, here comes one last straggler. Let's just see if he's going to stop before I do reposition. I'm a little bit worried they're going to start moving into this vegetation. It's very thick in this block, and although giraffe are one of the animals that we will off-road for, we can off-road for, it might be essentially counterproductive to try and follow them just because the sound of our vehicle moving might move them further into the dense vegetation, at least going off-road. They're not as accustomed to it as our leopards and our lions. There you go. Tall and elegant and very much missed. I feel like we've missed out on the giraffe sightings of late. Let's reposition. Hopefully they decide to move more out into the open. I actually spotted them, to be honest. I spotted them while we were with that gymnogene, or the harrier hawk, who eventually, by the way, flew away, much to the consternation of the starlings, who seem to be of the opinion that it's not allowed to sit down, and it's not allowed to fly away either. And essentially, the poor gymnogene can't win. Unfortunately, it looks as though our giraffe are in some relatively dense vegetation. I'll stick around for now to see whether or not they do pop out. But while we do that, let's go over to Brent so you can have a look at something pretty.
We're playing Around and Round the Paltiforum with a very cool little grasshopper. So it is of the bladderhopper family. Now, we've been looking at a few grasshoppers, and they're actually very interesting because they're very, very different. So you'll notice this grasshopper, he doesn't even have proper wing casings. So he's got sort of remnants of a wing casing, and his camouflage is his main form of defense. He's chosen a very bad bush to sit on because it's one he sticks on quite a lot. So grasshoppers are not all the same. So this is a bladder hopper, and I can tell that by his enlarged abdomen. Don't get scared, little dude. We're not going to eat you. I'm not that hungry today. But he would, if I was stuck out here, he would be definitely one of the grasshoppers I would eat. And you can see he's very, very cool. Slightly orange antenna, but his camouflage is what saves him. So we've got lots of different defense mechanisms with the different species of grasshoppers and how they behave. And isn't he very cool? Now, I was going to show you a flower, but I think we'll come back to the flower because I'm hoping another grasshopper we found just now, who is literally, in terms of looks and defense mechanisms, worlds apart from the bladder hopper. Now, I'm trying to rack my brain. Brian actually spotted it, and it was there he is, still there, an impressive spot. Now, he almost looks exactly like a stick insect. Look at that. So that is a grasshopper. Even though it looks, and he's designed specifically to look like a piece of grass. He's another grasshopper who's chosen a bad place to hide because it is one that sticks out. Now, this is a flying grasshopper species. So his wings are actually folded down along his back. And I'm quite sure he, if I remember correctly, these type, a lot of these type, maybe not him specifically, but a lot of these types of grasshoppers have what we call flash coloration, so bright colors under the wings. So when they jump, that shows this bright orange, which attracts attention of the predators, which you would think is counterintuitive. But as soon as they drop and close, it disappears. I don't want to disturb him, so I'm not going to get him to jump for us, but very, very, very cool, and shows you that even something like a grasshopper, you can have hundreds and thousands of variations of camouflage, of defensive mechanisms. Some are noxious, some are not. It's just incredible how diverse the insect kingdom is. That's so cool. Now, we don't want to disturb him. I'm sure he's just as hot as us. It is sweltering. So the cloud has come over, but it hasn't by any means diminished the heat. It is literally like a sauna. So it's a really hot, humid sauna. So if I'm dripping, I do apologize. Remember, this is live. Otherwise, I can't go and the makeup crew comes in, polishes us up, makes us look a bit better. That's not going to happen. I think my makeup would be running. It would be. Yes, there, yeah. If I had any makeup on. Fortunately, we don't need that out here. It's not very manly or rugged, is it? But okay. Now this is a flower. Now, strange enough, that grasshopper was sitting on the same species of plant, but the flower was not visible. Okay, let me just get down next to the flower. So this is a plumbago. How's that, Brian? I'll try not. No, that's not going to work. I shake too much. ADHD, you terrible thing, you. Okay, so this is a plumbago, and you can see a lot of the flowers. There's actually 1, 2, 3 that are still about to come out, and then there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 that have already flowered. So they're flowering at different times, and depending on the rain, normally you would find a lot of flowers in plumbago because of the drought, and it's probably holding some in reserve. Now, they've got a very interesting seed dispersal method. So these guys at the bottom here have already been pollinated, and you can see they just drop off. Now, if I was an impala or an inyala walking past, I mean, it's incredible. It's made to stick onto fur, but it is so sticky that it sticks onto my finger. Oh, that's gonna, whoop. But if I had to put that on my shirt or onto an animal, it really doesn't come off. I mean, see, that's incredible. So it's designed to stick onto animals as they go past or onto Brian's socks. Or fortunately, I don't wear socks. But so that's how they disperse. And I mean, it's sticky. And not only has it got little hooks and stuff on it, but it's actually sticky, like it's been covered in honey or whatnot. But it's absolutely incredible. Again, how not only the insect world, but the plant world has these amazing variations of dispersal of seeds and things like that. I'm always amazed by it. And that's the wonderful thing about jumping off the car from time to time. You get a chance to look a little bit deeper and still look for leopards. So I'm still convinced that Shongile and Hosanna are somewhere in this little drainage line. Hello, Bush Mum. And Bush Mum says, oh, there we go, off goes for some poor unsuspecting beastie to walk through. Bush Mum says all her plumbagos are purple and this one is white. So the non-indigenous to Africa plumbagos, and as far as I know, I think the purple or blue ones, they might be indigenous to Africa, but I think further up north in Africa. So in the bush and out in the wild in this part of Africa, the white plumbago is the indigenous one. But great to hear you've got plumbagos in your garden, Bushman. Be careful of those sticky seeds. They might get you. Or your dog, if you've got a dog or a cat, definitely they would become covered in plumbagos. Ooh, Byron's got something very small that we don't see often.
Just got a quick view of a slender mongoose. I'm just trying to see if he's still around there. Oh, I think he's disappeared into that thicket. Let's just have a look. There was a starling mobbing him and chasing it away. We raced into the area to see if it was perhaps a snake, but it was a slender mongoose. Now I wonder if we can get a glimpse of him. Oh, I think he's gone. I think he's disappeared. There he is. Oh. There are two of them. Very, very quick. Did you get a glimpse of them? too quick for us. Very, very shy little mongoose, the slender mongoose. It's not often you get to see two of them. I'll show you a picture of them. Oh, that's a pity they move so quickly. But don't worry, I'll get a picture quickly and show you what they look like. They've got little black tufts on the tail. And the reason those birds were mobbing it and alarm calling is because they try and they'll go for eggs and nests, raid them, basically looking for, like I say, eggs or even chicks. Little chicks that might be in there. Where is the slender mongoose? Now, this isn't a very good picture of one, but that is one over there. You can't see the tail, very thin tail with a black tip. Actually, there you can see it up there. That's it. Very cute little mongoose, but and interesting. I think there's a bit of a again, one of these cultural beliefs of these slender mongoose. And my tracker that I used to work with, Judas, used to tell me this often. And I'd always laugh at him and say, "Are you sure, Judas?" He goes, "No, I'm telling you." And what would happen is we'd see a slender mongoose, and usually, just like we saw earlier, they run across the road very quickly in front of you and they dart away. And what happens is they either run with their tail held up or they run with their tail flat. And Judas would always say, if the tail is up and it ran across the road, it was bad luck. And that's what they believe. A lot of the Shangaan people in this area believe that. And if the tail was flat and down and ran across, it would be good luck. So that one, I'm a little worried, because it ran halfway across with the tail down, and then as the bird came, the tail went up for the other half. So I'm not sure. Maybe we'll just be on even par this afternoon. But nice to see them. Very quick glimpse, though. But interesting to see the slender mongoose. Sure, I agree with Brent. It has become a bit of a sauna now with this cloud cover that's come over us. Very, very hot. So we're now going through some drainage lines, and we dip quite a bit. Just having a look. I'm trying to look in these areas because it's generally cooler, and we might be lucky with a bit more activity, animals moving through here. But so far, nothing. I'm so glad Jamie got to see those giraffe. That is a lovely sighting. We haven't seen giraffe for quite some time. One stone or two cats. You wanted to know what those mongoose eat. As I mentioned, you might have just missed it, but they feed on eggs or chicks, and they'll try and raid nests. Some of them do feed on reptiles. It depends on the species of mongoose. So some of these smaller little mongoose, like the dwarf mongoose that we get around here, we do see them fairly regularly. But they'll eat little invertebrates and insects. That's what they feed on. And then let me just show you the slender mongoose again, the one that we just saw. And the slender mongoose, hang on, it'll show you us here. Small rodents, birds, amphibians, fruits, even insects. So they feed on quite a wide variety, but they do raid nests quite a lot, quite regularly. So, but it depends, like I said, it depends on the mongoose species and what they feed on exactly. But a lot of them, insects are basically make up a big part of their diet. And then you do get, the ones that raid nests and eggs, and they'll eat reptiles, amphibians like frogs. So it all depends. All depends on the size of the mongoose and what they're looking for. Going through an area where I think the signal gets a bit tricky, so just bear with us.
through this drainage line. It's a little bit thick around here, but let's head back to Brent on the bushwalk and see what he's got.
Are we live, Brian? Can they see me? Oh no, sorry, what a surprise. No, of course, I'm just joking. So we've come out of that little riverbed, and we did find tracks of... Brian, stop following me. What are you doing? We did find tracks of one of the Karula's cubs, but we think it's the tracks of when she took it through to the little impound she had. And we've just popped up onto the sort of high ground above the drainage line. And we just want to listen a little bit. Aubrey's wandering ahead of us. We did hear some alarm calls from a rattling cisticula. So we don't want to sort of give the cubs a big fright by coming around in a very narrow area. So we've come out. Carry on, let's go. I'll stop trying to hide now. Now, of course, the wonderful thing about being on foot, and as I say, there's always something to say, and we've proved it from the vehicles, and when I say stop, and within 10 meters we'll find 10 interesting things, but because we've got a purpose, I'm only going to do one, and then we're going to walk. Oh dear, it doesn't have a flower. It's nearly got a flower, though. Let's see if one's got a flower close by. Oh dear, it hasn't been a good year for the wallfarriers. There are some, does it look like they're about to pop through? Yes, there's the signs of the flowers coming. Now, this is one of those funny little plants that doesn't have an English name. It's not that important and it's not that pretty, but it is that important if you're a butterfly. If you're a butterfly of the family of my favorite butterflies, the Acria butterflies. It is the... Oh, we can even see where the butterflies have been eating all the larvae. Look at that. You can see where the caterpillars have munched through the leaves here. And that is one of the Acria species, more than likely. And this is the little plant that the Acria butterflies gets its poison from. So it's a brightly orange and black butterfly. I'm afraid while we're on foot, we don't carry too many books and stuff, but I would recommend Googling Acria, A-C, oh dear, here comes spelling, A-C-R-A-E-A, if I remember correctly, something like that, Acria butterflies, and you should see how incredibly beautiful they are. And they possess hydrogen cyanide, and they sequester that poison from this wonderful little nondescript plant called Wallfaria indica. Okay, now we're going to head towards where we heard that cisticola. So a cisticula, cisticola, people say it in different ways. It is an LBJ, a little brown job, and unless you're an avid birder, a lot of times they're looked over. And a lot of them can only be told by their call. And in this area, we only really get the rattling. I've only seen zitting once. Can you believe there's a bird called a zitting cisticola? Brian, I'd go slightly to the left. There we go, you're on a big path. And don't want you to fall over like Gendre. And a zitting cisticola, the red-faced, a very embarrassed cisticola. Now, the red-faced cisticola, if you're ever in South Africa, and especially in this part, and you go down near a river that's got phragmites, so sort of like big reeds, you probably get it at home. It's the most common grass species in the world, occurs on every continent apart from Antarctica. And it's that long, sort of thin, quite sharpish reed, and they live inside those reeds only where there's water, and they've got actually quite a wonderful call. But I will find the call for you, but now we can hear cisticolas going mad, and that's why we came up here. You can see we're looking down on the drainage, and we think that this is where the little leopard cubs might be, especially judging from the cisticolas getting more and more upset as we get closer and closer. So we're going to check very, very carefully. And this would be an ideal place for Karula to leave those cubs. Oh, what's that eye? No, I thought I might have seen a spot or two. Can you hear them, Brian? Final control, I'm not sure if you can hear that. And there's about three or four of those little birds alarm calling. Okay, so isn't this exciting? There could be a leopard right here. Now, this with leopards, it's quite interesting. A lot of it depends on how you behave. You don't want to spend too long staring at an area. So leopard relies on camouflage. So then they tend to get a bit nervous and move away. But if you sort of, you know, nonchalant, have a glance, walk a little bit, have a glance. Have a glance, but I think if they are, they're going to be on. Ooh, it's a white stick. I thought it was a little bit of a tail. They're probably going to be on the other side of a big termite mound there. So what we're going to do is we're probably going to walk past the area till we can look back from a distance. That might give the cubs a little bit, if they are here, that might give them a bit of a feeling of safety. But it could also be a snake or a mongoose or anything. So if we can't see any sign of them, we'll actually probably go into that area to investigate, because it'd be really cool if it's a snake. So as we move on, you can see Aubrey there making sure I don't stumble into a buffalo. Ooh, I don't know if it's leopards. There's impala there. Could be a snake. You can see the impala through there. And so while we investigate what has irritated the rattling cisticulas so, let's go see what Byron's up to.
Now, we just got to Biffleshook Dam, everyone, and I was hoping there'd be something around here. But alas, there's nothing. There's nothing. Some bird species around, though. There's the Egyptian goose up in on the other side of the dam. A few of them, a pair of them. And then, what else have we got? Not much else. Even the regular water thickenies that are here. That we do see regularly. They're not around. I don't know where they are. Possibly hiding in the shade. It's nice and cool here, though. So I was hoping that something would come through and drink, but it doesn't look like it at all. Sure. Sometimes your plans just don't work out, which is okay. It's a bush, and you can't ever predict what's going to happen. I must admit, I'm driving rusty for the first time in a long time. And I know Brent was struggling to turn around and he took the door off. And it makes such a big difference. I must be honest, it's so nice to be able to turn around easily and not have the door squashing against us or stopping our legs. There's some little three-banded plovers. Let's see, yeah, there we go. They've just landed, one or two running around in the middle of the mud over here. Beautiful birds, beautiful birds. I think we should possibly just continue from here and see what else we can find. Hang on, what little birds are those? Oh, two blue waxbills. Have a look, just ahead of us. You might see them flying around. Let's see where. There we go. There's one. Blue waxbill. Wonderful. Look at that beautiful little bird. There are two of them there. Oh, these are some of my favorite little birds. Blue waxbills. That is really, really great. They are so colorful, but so difficult to see. Oh, there are three of them. Well, this is a treat. I know this is the first for me to be able to get them on cameras. I don't know how many times you've seen these. They are very, very beautiful little birds. That's nice. Nice little surprise. See, when you just sit around and wait, things happen around you. You get these little birds that you don't see often coming through. It's always nice to do a bit of birding. There's some of the starlings around that are usually here, the Birchall starling. Then there's red-billed buffalo weavers also around. There's one right in front of us that's just landed. That's a lovely view of it. And see how hot these birds are, all trying to cool down by opening their beaks and allowing that cool breeze to blow through their beaks. And that helps cool the birds down. That's a really nice view of the red-billed buffalo weaver. So you see, just when you think, well, there's not much going on, there's actually a lot going on around you. You just need to have patience, scan around and see what there is to appreciate. And it may not necessarily be animals, or large animals, but it could be birds, it could be insects, it could be butterflies. anything like that. That was nice. Very nice surprise. I'm glad we got to see those little blue wax bills. Aren't they cute? They're wonderful little birds to see. There's a lot of them. Quite a few of those little wax bills around. Oh, let's see. Again, I'm still in search of elephant. I've been looking around and unfortunately haven't had any luck. And I was so spoilt. Hang on, there's a little dacre and he's stopped. There we go. Beautiful view of a male dacre. Look at those little horns. Only the males have horns. The females don't. I'm keeping my voice down because we saw earlier, and as I explained, they generally run off very quickly, and there they go. Let's see if he does his... not quite. They've got... they've got an interesting running style where they run and it appears as if they're jumping and looping or diving through the bush. And that's where the name Dacre comes from. It's spelled D-U-I-K-E-R. And it's a Dutch or Afrikaans word which means diver. And I think it comes from that way that they bound through the bush. And you can just... You see how secretive they are and how well they blend in to the surroundings. That was a nice little surprise. Now, as I was saying, I've been trying to look for some elephant, and we were so spoiled a month ago. We had elephants everywhere on Juma, and they've just dispersed. They've just moved out. There's probably a lot of food all over the place for them now, so they don't need to be here, which is one of those things. I'm sure they'll be back at some point. Maybe move down towards the rivers where there's a lot more water and vegetation to feed on. Now I'm trying to think what our next plan will be. There goes a cuckoo, another cuckoo. Let's see if it sits. There, it did sit. Hang on, we might get it through here. There we go, VM. I don't think, and there it goes. Now I'd love to see that cuckoo because I think that's the African cuckoo. And I'd like to see the difference between that one and the one we saw earlier. Let's just have a look here quickly. Let me just scan. See if we can see it sitting anywhere. I fear it may be gone. You see anything, VM? No. I think it's flown away very, very quick. And again, that's very different to the behavior of that other cuckoo that we saw. But I do think that might have been the African cuckoo. All right, well, I'm going to work out a new plan and see what we can do and what we can look for. While I do that, let's head back to Brent for an update.
Well, we followed up on those cysticular alarm calls. And, Brian, what did the killer bees say they were going to do today? Oh, and look at bugs. Did we find a leopard and look at bugs?
Potentially.
I think we potentially did. So one of the little cubs has just moved away from us. We don't want to go in and spook him just yet. How's this, Brian? Yeah. So there we go. You can see the footprint there. So it was lying right here and watching us without moving. And you can see it hasn't run off. It's walked off. So we haven't spooked it. We said we weren't going to tell anyone if we found a leopard, but we lied. We called Jamie. So she's on her way here. We are going to keep moving a little bit, see if we can find the leopard. But as I said, you've got to listen to all those things. Those little brown jobs, those indescript birds that people drive past, they found us a leopard today. Now, it is quite thick here, and of course we don't want to spook the cubs too much on foot. We're going to keep our distance a little bit, see if we can spot them from a distance, and then wait for the vehicle to come in. So I don't think Karula's here. I think she's still off hunting, but... What do you say, Brian? I say killer bees.
Killer bees.
And Aubrey, of course. Aubrey is being, yes. There we go, Aubrey. There we go. Yes. Okay. So we're gonna move through here very quietly. So that cub's probably headed down back down towards where there's some big trees and drainage lines. And we're hoping by staying a little bit further away, these cubs are very relaxed on foot. I've been within 5 meters of them just staring at me. I've actually been hissed at by Hosanna when I found him on a kill on foot. But so we're going to just walk very slowly, and I'm quite sure once Jamie gets here, if she gets down below us here in a vehicle, she will find one of them, or hopefully both of them. So we're just going to see if we can spot them from a bit of a distance. As I said, we don't want to spook them. Now, they've probably been watching us for 20 minutes. Half an hour watching us as we scuttled about looking at flowers and grasshoppers. But our whole intention, and this is one of the important things when it comes to tracking animals on foot, you've got to stop and think like an animal. So we knew Karula. This morning we only had Karula's tracks going off to the northwest. So we know she's going to leave the cubs, and this is ideal place to leave the cubs. So we've just want to check down. So they're probably, if they are going to look, they're just going to peek over the edge at us. I'm pretty certain they're in here somewhere. No, we actually 100% certain, not pretty certain. We can hear Jamie on her way. And I think maybe we'll walk up to the road and meet Jamie. Send her in here, because she's going to definitely be able to give you a much better view of those leopards in the vehicle than we're going to be able to do on foot. And then, since we've done, you know, the finding the leopards, we'll go look for some more bugs. So I said, we just don't want to disturb them too much. And, of course, all these interactions with leopards on foot and things like that, by not putting pressure on them, is very important, because it makes them far more comfortable when you track them in the future. I mean, you look at Mr. Tingana. When he first arrived, he used to disappear in a blaze of glory. And now on foot, he's actually relatively relaxed. And that takes work, and that's not rushing things. So, I mean, we could easily just stumble down there and see the cubs and get a quick glimpse. But, I mean, after that, they're going to be spooked, and it's going to be difficult for the vehicles to come in and find them. So half the point of tracking is it's not to have the longest view on foot. It's to find the animal and then get a vehicle in there so you can view it with a minimal amount of effect. And also, I just love tracking. It's a dying art form, and fortunately, the safari industry is keeping it alive. Otherwise, I think tracking would probably be lost in this part of Africa. There we go. We can spot who's that through there. Is that Jamie? It is. So we're going to go jump ahead to Jamie, and we're going to get her to come in here with the vehicle. And sorry, Brian. Forgot about you there, this long pole and whatnot. So we're just going to go let Jamie know where they were. So we're definitely sure there was one from the tracks, but it is quite hard there, so there could be another very easily. So there we go. Who's with Jamie? It's Jandre. There we go. Okay, so you're gonna come on. Oh, sorry, Brian, I forgot there. We're gonna go on a little venture. I'm just gonna give you a little behind insight into how the tracking team / to the vehicle works. And then while Jamie goes off-road to find, we'll go visit Byron. But let's go have a chat to Jamie first. Hello. No. No, you don't need to walk far when you know where to find the leopards.
Is that nice and easy?
Yes, oh, it was. We've been looking at ho-hos.
Hello.
Hello, everyone.
Okay, so if you go in pretty much in the line we walked out, there's a big knobthorn tree. Hey, Orbs, what do you think there? A little bit. Yeah, start from this side. Yeah, yeah. So they're definitely there, but we spooked them, so we don't want to keep spooking them. Rather, you guys go in the car.
Perfect.
We're going to go look for some more bugs.
Okay.
Okay,
well,
so.
You know what
one does on a Sunday afternoon. So we're going to go across to Byron, and hopefully, Jamie will be back with you with those incredible little cubs shortly.
That's so exciting. I'm so glad Brent managed to find the leopards. I'm not sure how many there are around there, but Jamie's going to go and investigate, and hopefully we'll get a nice view of them. I wonder if Karula is back with the cubs on that side. We had tracks of her, as I said this morning, heading all the way in front of Vuyatela camp from last night, but it just shows you how far she can walk when she's potentially looking for food, out hunting. She covers a huge area. So it would be wonderful to see if they're all there. So it's still incredibly hot and humid. We haven't had any luck just yet with anything else. I've been driving all over, really. Just the way it happens sometimes. We've hardly seen impala even this afternoon. Now that I think about it, we've only seen a few of them. I don't see some. Sorry, I thought I saw something interesting. Let's just have a look. No, sorry, Vian. It was a bush that appeared to look like an animal. There was nothing there. False alarm. Oh, Michael, you wanted to know how many different types of cuckoos are there. Now I just need to count quickly. Let's see what I can get through. So there's, let's start with the smaller ones. So a Diedrich cuckoo, class as cuckoo. We then have Jacobin levalens, the African cuckoo, red-chested cuckoo, common cuckoo, the thick-billed cuckoo, what's the other one? The great spotted cuckoo, that's 9. Emerald cuckoo, I've seen that, that's 10. Okay, then what else? I think there's a Madagascar cuckoo that it's very rare, but it can occur here occasionally. That's 11. Let me see for Southern Africa. Let's see if I'm right. I think I'm pretty close, so that's 11. Let's see if I've missed one. All right, so African cuckoo, we said, emerald cuckoo, long-tailed barred cuckoo, which I have not seen, and I'm assuming that's very rare. That's up in Zimbabwe and Mozambique, so we don't get that down here in South Africa. The black cuckoo, I forgot that, so that's 13. Common cuckoo, we said, Diedrich, we said, great spotted, Jacobin, classes, the lesser cuckoo. Also, that up in Zimbabwe and Mozambique, so not down here. The levalens, we said, Madagascar, we said, red-chested, thick-billed. And that's it. That's it for Southern Africa. So what's that? 14 species. 14 species of cuckoo that we get. So, Michael, I hope that answers your question. I was close. I missed 3. And those are ones we don't really see here. I've never seen them. They're up in Zimbabwe and Madagascar. I mean, Zimbabwe and Mozambique. Diane,
Byron, now the European bee eaters, you wanted to know if they compete with the other bee eaters around or compete for nesting sites or fight for food. So not necessarily, Diane. The reason for that is the bee eaters all fit a different niche. They all have a specific role to play. Also, the bee eaters vary in size, some of them. So they might feed on, for example, the European bee eaters will feed on larger insects as opposed to little bee eaters who will feed on smaller insects. But they won't, they also, some of the bee eaters don't nest in these areas. Some will nest in the banks of riverbeds and in the ground, like the carmine bee eaters. So they look for different nesting sites to the European bee eaters. So it all depends. So each one has a specific role or niche within nature that it fits, so they avoid competition that way. I think Jamie's still trying to see if she can find those leopards. I wonder if they didn't get a fright perhaps when they saw Brent. Occasionally it may cause them to move away a little bit. But some of them are, especially Karula and her youngsters, I think are a little bit more used to being tracked and found on foot. So they're not as skittish as some leopards can be, but they will most likely still move away, especially those little cubs. But Jamie is still in the area having a look around, so it'll be interesting to see if they have moved or if they're still in the same area. Probably just moved a little bit into the thicker drainage line. Try and hide out there, but I'm sure Jamie will have some luck fairly soon. Aaron, you asked if we could go to Treehouse Dam and you'd like to see the goslings. Actually, I was at Treehouse Dam earlier and we didn't see any goslings there this afternoon. They're possibly still in the area, but this afternoon we didn't see them. We started out down there and we didn't see them. I felt one or two little drops, raindrops. Now I wonder, have a look at this dark cloud in front of us. Now this could get fairly interesting. Maybe a bit later, not now, hopefully. And we'll see, maybe we get some rain. I'm going to see if we can get a glimpse of what's going on down at Sydney's Dam, maybe. And just see if there's some animals down there. We do need a lot more rain, though, to really fill these dams up. They're still dry, very dry, as we saw with Biffles Hook Dam earlier. There's not a lot of water around in those dams. We need more water, I think, for the animals to really come into the area where there's a lot more water, cleaner water for them to drink. I think that's possibly why they've also moved off into other areas. Maybe the rivers have filled up a bit more. So it's better to drink down there than it is in these old muddy dams that don't have much water. Oh, there we go. Finally, some animals, some zebra. Look at that, an impala. Oh, wonderful. Ah, there's a marabou stork out there too. But firstly, let's look at those zebra. There's a marabou stork on the ground. Oh, sounds like Brent's got Karula on foot. Let's go have a look quickly.
The killer bees. So what's happened is I think we saw Hassana where Jamie's looking now. We're not far and we found Karula and Shongile. So I'm just going to call Jamie. Now Karula is the most incredible animal on foot. She is so relaxed. I mean, she knows I'm here. I think I saw her at the same time she saw me. Jamie.
Are you coming?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Can you use number one?
Jamie, come up Rebecca's. I think that's Hosanna there. We've got Karula and Shongile on a termite mound. If you come onto Rebecca's, where that big seep line heads to the north, there's a single jackalberry, quite a skinny one. We've got both of them lying up on that termite mound. So if you come back in, and when I get your audio, I'll call you in towards us. Isn't this exciting? Move across. Okay, I'm going to move across a bit, Brian. Okay. AFM Jam, still on the west. So just as you get to Rebecca's, at that large seep line that runs parallel to the drainage system about 100 metres, 150 metres further to the west, you should get our visual not too far from the road. Look at this. Isn't this exciting, guys? Leopard, that's the third leopard on foot. Copy, no problem. They're very relaxed. So, I mean, with Karula, we've had closer sightings on foot, but there's no need. We're going to sit here. Isn't this absolutely amazing? And, you know, it's what happens when you put the killer bees together. Look at that. I mean, they're both well aware we're here. So, good news is Hosanna's not far. He's probably 400 meters from us. And I'm pretty sure if she heads south from here, she will definitely find them. Even if she starts calling, even soft calling from here, she will find him again. I'm starting to wonder if maybe they don't have a killer around there. It's possible not. Isn't this wonderful? Look, see how relaxed she is? She's lying down. This is amazing. Oh, hello, little Shongololo. Of course, she's not a Shongololo, but she is very, very cute. Remember, this is 100% live. We are with Leopards on Foot, live from South Africa. And if you want to send us any questions or comments, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or questions@wildearth.tv. We're with the Queen Karula and Shongile, the little princess. Isn't this absolutely amazing? So, here we go. I'll show you what happened. We were walking through here, and that little gap that Brian thing. So, literally, we spotted here. We're following this game path that I'm on here, and I just looked, and the termite mound flicked in the air. I was like, that looks like a leopard. Oh dear. Whistle, whistle, just in case they're not relaxed. But you can see she's completely aware of us and absolutely not trying to move away at all. And we have had some amazing bushwalks with Karula. Well, you were with James on that termite mound. It's very similar sort of situation to this. Yeah. And I think while I raced to get there, it took me about 15 minutes and you just sat with her.
Yeah.
And this is awesome. Oh, it looks like, hold on, maybe she'll climb the tree. For fun. Yeah. She tends to do that. Let's try from a little bit over here, see what she's up to. And she looks like she is looking. Oh, sorry, Brian. You can just see her tail there now. And she's just gone behind that little jackalberry. You got it. She's just to the right now. Yeah, let's move for Karula, I think. Now, in certain cases, if I know a lot of you remember another favorite, there she is. She's actually coming closer to us. Maybe if you guys remember young Sindile, he used to do that. He used to actually follow us back to the car when we used to find him on foot. Oopsie. Thanks, Orbs. So I'm just handing the radio over to Orbs so he can call Jamie in while we sit here with the leopards. Brian, I know the sun's not ours, but would you say we're basking?
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, we're definitely basking. I mean, look at that. She's lying down. We are probably 60 feet, 70 feet. What's that in meters? I don't know. 40 meters? Maybe a bit less. from her, and she knows we're here, and so does little Shongi. Shongi's actually coming closer to us, but she's moving through the thickets, and we don't want to move too much, but she's watching us. It almost looks like she's having a bit of a game with us, and she's trying to sneak towards us at the moment. If you come here, Ryan, where I am, can just make out she's sneaking, she's laying down there, and she's been sneaking towards us slowly and pretending we're a Franklin. We're a bit too big for you, little one. How awesome is this? As you can see, I mean, not a care in the world. Now, she's on the move again. This is one of those really special moments in bushwalk. It's not something we get to do often, is actually spend this much amount of time with a leopard on foot. And, oh, amazing. I mean, she's fiddling around. You can see by her body language, she's 100% relaxed. Now, she might try flank us. Oh no, she's found something else that's keeping you entertained there. What have you found? I'll move a little bit. I think it's going to be a bit better. She's found something there. Oh no, she's bored with it now. It looks like she's bored with us as well. She's heading back towards Karula. Where's Mom? Let's go. See if she's gone behind the termite mound now. But Mom's still sitting on top. Karula, that was our route home, man. Where is she there? You can just make her out. She's fast asleep. You can see lying flat on it. Oh, she's lifted her head. I'm just keeping an eye out where little trouble Shongile is. There she is. What is she up to? You see her, Brian? Mm-hmm. So basically in that little sort of arc, that quarry branch comes over, she's directly under there. She moved again. She's fiddling around in the little Timberti thicket at the back.
Somewhere through there.
Yeah, she's there. You just saw the moon go back a little bit? She's just through to the right of that big branch, but she's... I'm going to keep an eye on her. Hopefully she pops out into the open again. I can hear Jamie on her way. Let's try to see if we can get a nice view of Karula before we make space for Jamie to go in. I think from over here, Brian's going to be the best. Or am I? Oh, we got a beautiful view of Shongile, though. There he goes, he's just watching us. Hello, Trouble, we see you too. Oh, tired kitty. Oh man, they are such exquisite creatures. He's chasing lizards. What's she doing? Up to nonsense. Yeah, so she's playing around, chasing lizards, and completely ignoring us. But Jamie and Jandre have on foot. There we go. We're going to hand it over, but we're going to take one question quickly, and it's from another Jamie who would like to know, have we ever seen them hunt or kill any birds? I've seen them attempt to catch Franklin, but I haven't seen them succeed yet. But now, of course, we're not going to put any pressure by getting too close on foot. We've had such an amazing experience on foot, and we've got Jamie and Jandre now, and who can go see what shenanigans she's up to. Looks like she's chasing lizards and the like, so we're gonna let you go in there with Jamie, and let's just say the killer bees might be quite loud around the campfire tonight.
Oh my.
How cool is this? Well done. Having a very nice walk there.
It's very nice walk.
Oh, two leopard sightings on foot. Brian. Bye-bye. Well done, tracking team. Bushwalk team. I don't know where I'm going. I'm assuming somewhere there. How exciting is that? My apologies for the slight delay in trying to find our way in here, but we are now in here. And now we just have to find the leopard. Don't you think it would be terribly embarrassing if we couldn't? It would be most cringeworthy, right? I heard words about termite mounds and jackalberries, so I'm assuming I'm going in the right direction. And this was the direction that Brent was... Oh, there. Okay. Relief. We can all breathe easy. I can see the leopard. What a fantastic... Karuna really is such a star on foot. He's so incredibly comfortable with the presence of vehicles. And judging by the vehicle tracks that are here, somebody's been around this area not so long ago. Hello, Karula. Oh, it's been a long time since I've seen her. Where's your little madam? Ah, there's little madam. I'll just stop here for a second just to get the lie of the land and to figure out exactly what's happening and which way we should go. There is the magnificent Queen of Juma, Karula. Feels like a long time since I last saw her. Probably has only been a week or so, but it does feel like ages since I last had a chance to actually view her. So the cub that we were tracking earlier must be Hosanna. He probably has met up with his mom at some point. They were separated the last time that Karula was seen. She was with Shungile and her meal, and Hosanna was in quite a distance away, in a drainage line or a dried up riverbed. And we were just saying that it's a relatively common thing as these leopard cubs get slightly older, the fact that they will move further and further afield. And I think Hosanna is doing just that. I have no doubt that she actually had already found him and that they'd been reunited. And probably he's just gone on yet another adventure. What have you got there? Has she got something? I think she's got a bird. Come on, let's go reposition quickly. I think she's got a bird there. Another kill for Shungile. Oh. No, that's definitely not a bird. That is a small impala. So there is definitely a kill in the form of a baby impala. There we go. So a little bit of a sad sight. Just hold on a second. We're going to reposition because Shungile might actually start playing with this carcass again. Ilana, you wanted to know, welcome back as always, by the way, you wanted to know how Karula was named the Queen of Juma. I think it's a title that she's very much earned. I think it's a title that's come from Safari Live and the viewers there. There she is. Here we go. Okay, so for sensitive viewers, the Impala lamb is not alive. Sorry. James is trying to get hold of me. Oh, look at this little thing. Sorry, everybody. Just give me 1 second and then we can talk about it. Oh, there we go. Brent's got it. So she's obviously got a kill. Sorry, Ilana. Let me get into the Queen of Juma in a moment. I just want to talk a little bit about the fact that we've got a leopard cub with a kill first. And the fact that, once again, Queen Karula has provided for her cubs. Now, it's very unlikely that Shungile caught the baby impala herself. However, what we've seen more and more with Karula is that she allows the cubs to possibly even, as we saw with Hosan and the baby Inyala, possibly even conduct the kill themselves. So after she's caught the animal, she lets them kill it, or she lets them have the first opportunity to, first of all, to play with their food, and then to open up the carcass, which is all very, very important for their future well-being. And that, of course, is half of the reason that she is called Queen Karula. So, Ilana, back to your question. She is the main female of Juma. She's actually had one of the biggest female leopard territories in this area on record. Ah, you don't want your impala. Hello, gorgeous girl. Actually, I do know when I last saw Karula. I saw her on foot 2 days ago. But it's not quite the same as being in the vehicle and having a chance to be up close to them. I actually saw Shungile and Karula from the vehicle. So yes, Karula is the queen for many reasons. One is that her territory was the center of Juma. What you seen? What have you seen, little girl? Something hidden there. Oh, it's a tortoise. It's a tortoise. Hold on. She's got a tortoise. You okay there, Jandre? Here we go. Does your curiosity know no bounds, little one? And like all baby cats, she has found herself the challenge of a tortoise, but completely unlike a lion, she doesn't have the jaw strength to actually break the shell. But it's very common to see them. Oh, we're done now. Is it not that interesting? Is it a living tortoise, or is it one very terrified living tortoise, or is it a dead, just an empty shell? It looks very much to me like one terrified living tortoise. Well, she's gone back to the kill again. Oh, it's quite sad seeing these little impala lambs, but we know that this is all part of the... Oh, look at her playing. It is all part of nature, and this playing that she's going to do now is very important. Bravo! That was impressive. How amazing was that? After all of that. Oh, Shungile, almost. See how capable these little cats are? She just hoisted it. Oops. That was a good try, Shungile. It was a very good try. Practice makes perfect. You can't be as slick as your mom straight away. You gotta have a few experimental tries and a few fall downs. Now, the cub that you're looking at is 10 months old and already exhibiting the instincts that should be necessary to keep her alive. She's gonna try again. She's gonna try again. Oh, maybe not. Actually, that last jump was a little bit of a hefty one. Oh, we owe a big thank you to our walking team this afternoon. This is amazing. There's that bright-eyed look of Shungile when she starts to play with her kill. We've also seen it with Hosanna. And although it is hard to watch, at least the impala isn't suffering. And it does mean that she can practice biting where the joints are, where the weak parts of the impala are. All of those are going to be crucial for her in the future. Okay, I'm just going to reposition just to shuffle around. Wait, hold on. She's up again. Now, Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, you wanted to know if Shungile still has two sets of canines. Now, the last time I saw her, she gave us a big yawn, and I was able to just notice that she had still had her milk teeth, plus her permanent teeth growing through. So she had two canines on her top jaw. Or two sets of canines on her top jaw. I'm going to hazard a guess and say no. I think there's a jolly good chance that milk tooth is now out or has fallen out, but we'll try and get you a good view for that in a moment. Doing the leopard waddle. The leopard drag waddle. You're going to... It would be very ambitious if you thought you were going to put it up that jackalberry, Shungile. Although I am seriously impressed with your display of strength and almost skill. Let's call it strength. I'm not quite sure that skill is the way forward. Standing by, James. Negative, James. I don't. Hold on one moment. Sorry, everybody. I'm just going to take my earpiece out. James is trying to make his way in. Brent is helping him out. Just shush, Brent. Hold on. Shush. Shush. Oh, affection between Mom and Shungile. James, I've got your audio now as well. Sorry, everybody. I was just trying to get a word in edgeways there. Shame, Brent was very, very kindly helping us out. AFM, if you want to switch off now, I'm about to reposition. You'll get my audio. Okay, let's reposition, go around. Shungile is tired of her kill. Gonk. Shungile is tired of the... No, she's back again. She's come back. Oh, dear. Shungile, you're really keeping us guessing. Oh, they have got a baby impala here. Bouncing us all over the show, girl. She's bouncing between Mom... Oh, catch that tail. What's that? Now back to the impala carcass again. Who's there? Is that James coming to visit you? Yes. Where's your brother, madam? Hmm? Your brother's being very naughty. Off on his own like this. And I'm sure, I have no doubt that he knows where Mom is, and he's just gone on his own little mission. Look at her tucking into her impala. Now, most of what you're seeing she's going to be practicing is the grab of the neck and the bite around the nose. And those are the two techniques that leopards will favor when they're trying to hunt and kill something. So this really is invaluable practice. Even on a hot day like today, you can see she's panting, she's hot and tired, but it's too good an opportunity to miss. Sorry, I'm just going to take my foot off the brake. I got so excited, I slammed my foot on it and didn't take it off. Oh, it's tackling it. And just by the way, for those of you that are wondering, for our viewers familiar with everything that's going on with our lives, James is guiding some special Nat Geo guests. How was that for a little ninja move? So that's why he is not on drive on the live safaris, but he is on game drive. A beautiful curl of that tail. Okay, we're done now. James said, was it this morning or was it no, it must have been yesterday. Let's see if we can see that canine. She's definitely got her permanent bottom canines. Nope. Oh, leopards are the ultimate ninjas. There we go. Taking it round to that side of the termite mound. You see your canines? You see the two bottom ones are fully grown, or at least permanent. Can't see the top ones. Look how she's panting in the heat. It's been quite an exhausting afternoon for her. I wonder when Mom caught this. Probably not too long ago. Oh, sorry, I remember what I was about to say. James, a couple of days ago, was saying that she looks like Shadow. I disagree. I think she looks... Well, I don't strongly disagree. I think he's right, but I think that she looks more like Tundi, which is her other aunt. And Tundi is Shadow's sister. So Shadow and Tundi are Karula's oldest daughters. I love that little face. So special. Those massive feet, nearly the size of her mom's now. I wonder if she's going to be bigger or smaller than Mom. Fly. This is behavior that many of you that have domestic cats will recognize. When they've caught things like a mouse or perhaps a bird, and they get this dilated pupil look, and they start to play with their food, and they act completely crazy, like a little silly 5 minutes or silly 10 minutes, where they play around with it. It's very, very similar to what leopards do. Right. Now, Shungile, if I go all the way around the termite mound, are you going to come back onto this side? Yes, probably. Just because. Pretty girl. Okay. What do you think, Chandra? Should we risk it? Go on to the other side. She could pop down here any second now.
Why not?
She's completely lost, completely lost that baby look that she had. There's no more of the fluffiness, that cub-like face. Now she looks like a little miniature leopard. And not even that little. Her son is nearly the height of Mum. In fact, he's actually quite... At first glance, it can actually be quite difficult to tell the difference between Karula and Hosanna from behind or from a distance. Hosanna's feet are bigger than Karula's now. And a very good afternoon to you, Lucy. While we look at our 10-month-old cub, you want to know how long it will be before the cubs become independent from Karula. It's slightly earlier with the females. Shungile has probably got another six to eight months with Mom, probably about 8 months. So they reach about a year and a half, and then they move away from Mom, and they start becoming more independent. The males take a little bit longer and are often still living around their mothers, and sometimes even still sharing kills with her, even once they've reached 2 or so years old. It is so adorable and yet so macabre at the same time. Oh, look at your belly. She is having fun. It's a lot of practice as well, but she is having fun too. We've been so spoilt with the royal family recently. I'm just hoping that before the end of this sunset safari that Hosanna might decide to come and rejoin them. That's what I would like to see before it gets too dark and we have to leave. I'm hoping that Karula might go, and she might even go and fetch him, if we're lucky, and bring him back. It would be lovely to see the royal family reunited once again. So for our new viewers, Hosanna is Shungile's brother, so the twin brother of this leopard cub that you're looking at now. They were born from the same litters, in the same litter. Okay. I'm a ninja. She's seriously practicing her skills and coordination. And there is nothing quite so agile as a leopard here. In terms of our big predators, leopards are truly graceful. Marianne, the age-old question, is it not? You want to know if the neck biting is instinctive or if it's learned from their mum. It's instinctive. She would know to do that regardless of whether or not Mom had taught her. Mom hasn't necessarily taught her. Mom hasn't actually all that often. Mom hasn't actually hunted in front of them. So I would say it's almost pure instinct, and practicing grabbing on to the impala carcasses that Mom's let her play with, or Nyala, or Dacre carcasses, whatever it happens to be. You're going to go and bug Mom now. Ah, oh, tired. Tired for, no, I can see in your expression you're not going to go to sleep. I can see it. Yeah. You're hot, and you want, and you should, but you're not going to. You are like an overly hyped up child. Told you. Oh, it's kicking, careful. It's not kicking, by the way. It is, as I said, it is dead. So it's not suffering, it's not feeling any pain. It was probably over very quickly for it. It's amazing watching what is... what is instinctive and what is not with the big cats. And for the most part, leopard hunting is almost pure instinct. And the reason that we can say that with such... I feel as though we can say that with such comfort is I think Sandile is a very, very good example. I don't think that Shadow spent much time teaching him how to hunt. And he was then put in quarantine for 8 months, where he was quarantined, he was fed, so he didn't have to hunt for himself. And when he got back and was released back into the Sabi sand, 8 months later, he was fully capable of catching and providing for himself. I think that speaks volumes about the nature of a leopard's hunting instinct. It is a very, very powerful force indeed. It is their motivating, driving factor. And cubs are already showing that instinct from when they're cubs playing with mom's tail. Welcome to Chitra. You wanted to know if leopards are solitary hunters. Yes, they are. There are a few recorded cases, or not cases, but a few recorded examples. Whee! You thought she was going up, Chandra. She's playing tricks on you. there are a few recorded cases of males and females seeming to cooperate to hunt, particularly when they're mating, or perhaps mother and almost adult offspring, but for the most part they are solitary creatures, they're solitary by nature, they're solitary hunters. Oh, I just have this feeling if I go all the way around there, she's going to come back around here and bounce back into the side of the termite mound. I do hope many of you got the screenshot, so I have to... oh, is she, see? Are we doing a lovely dance this afternoon? Alright, while we decide which position we want to take on the termite mound, I think we should go quickly across to Brent, because of course we do have a massive thank you to say to him. So we'll be back with you shortly, but for now, over to Brent Upop.
Mail and Nyala to bid us farewell as we cross quarantine on our way towards home. Beautiful big Mel, he's keeping a close eye on us. Oh, he's decided we are not a threat. He's going to continue his... very proud stride. I do love the orange socks on Inyana. They do look a little ridiculous. But it's been absolutely wonderful. The killer bees have enjoyed having you on the walk with us. We've seen some grasshoppers. We've seen a flower or two. We found an egg. And you know what? Where's my egg gone now? The lucky beans must have done the trick. So it's been wonderful having you on foot. And remember, we do have a fireside chat this evening. So Brian and I are going to go set that up. So we'll be seeing you again before the end of show. But we're going to slowly amble home. And we'll see you again tomorrow morning. Actually, I won't see you. Brian will be with you tomorrow morning. I won't. But I'll see you the day after for the next safari. So let's go see what Byron's been doing in the bush.
So we are still out here, everyone. We've just had absolutely no luck at finding anything. I've been looking and driving everywhere and we've found nothing. I don't know if it's the heat, the weather, or what it is, but been looking all over and just nothing is popping out. We've checked just about every water hole, every dam, and still no luck. But as I always say, it's too soon to panic. You know, Jamie's had incredible sighting with Karula and those cubs. I'm so happy. That really is special and fantastic to see. I'm glad they're so active now. But and again, you know, that's all a learning curve for those little cubs. But anyway, we are still in search of anything, and I'm almost back at Treehouse Dam. Gonna head back into that area and just have a look around there and see if anything's come down, or if we've had movement from any animals around there. But it is very quiet this afternoon for some reason. But there's still a lot of bird life around, and there's lots of insects calling. I can hear cicada in the distance. You can actually hear one off to the left.
little cicada. There's a Cokey Franklin calling in the distance. Oh, and a Dacre. See, just as I say, there's not much going on. We find a little antelope. And we stop to talk about a cicada, and then these tiny antelope pop out. So there is still activity out here. That Cokey Franklin calling in the distance. I wonder if we'll be able to find one. It's a terrible Cokey Franklin call. It's a very strange sound. I don't think I can do that. All right, let's see what else we can find. While I do that, let's head back to Jamie and those beautiful leopards.
What a truly magical sighting this has been with the royal family. At the moment, their tails almost intertwined, and of course Shungile has now decided to plonk herself down on the other side of the termite mound, or not quite on the other side of the termite mound. She's so distracted and so hyped up, but she's also boiling. And it's getting hotter and hotter and more humid this evening. I think the storm is on its way. I think that finally, despite her excitement, her body's forced her to stop and just have a bit of a break and to cool down. And it's so easy to imagine Karula. I mean, now I'm really anthropomorphizing, so I'm going to preface this by saying I'm really anthropomorphizing this. But it's so easy to imagine Karula saying, Shungile, would you calm down and just stop playing with your dinner? And Shungile saying, I'm not Shungile, I'm the shadow, dark shadow. Dark Shadow, the Slayer of Impala. The amount of fun that she has been having. Hey, Karula. Karula's just sitting there. She's seen this all before. Right. Okay. Shungile, if I reposition, are you going to go onto the other side of the termite mound? Yes, probably. But let's do it anyway. Let's do it anyway. Sorry, I'm stuck. There we go. How wonderful is the sighting been? Oh, shame. I think that's Mom. Oh, shame. Can you see it there, Jandre? And she's in the bushes. It's the female impala. Oh no, she's hidden there. Yep. Standing by, James. I am live, thanks, James. We just stopped for the mother, the female impala, but I'm making my way that side. So we're just going to pop our heads over the termite mound and have a look. Oh no, this is actually not going to work. Otherwise we're going to get all of our guests on camera and not Shungile and Karula. I think it should go all the way around. Sorry. Shame. So that poor female impala, she's probably only just given birth to that little one. And unfortunately for her, as is very common for impala births, it didn't make it. Such a short and quite... such a very short life. Sorry, everybody. Just for our new viewers, the reason we've done such a wide turn is because there are certain species of tree that we can drive over and certain species of tree that we can't. In that case, we couldn't drive over some of the trees, but the trees that we do drive over will spring right back up. Hello, big girl. There we go. That is the perfect view of the royal family. Or at least two of the three members of the royal family. Well done, Karula. Clever girl. You can see her canines starting to yellow, starting to age a little bit. She is turning 13 in a couple of months. But I think that age has just given her even more in terms of experience and ability with her cubs. And we're not just saying that because we love her, because we do, of course, but it's actually because it's borne out. The evidence is right here in front of us. Trungile is nearly at that 12-month stage where a leopard's survival rate very rapidly increases, especially for a female. Once she hits sexual maturity, she's going to be, in terms of the biggest threats, she's going to be out of the woods. James is pulling faces at me. Michael, he wanted to know what part of her territory Karula might give Trungile. It's impossible for us to predict, and it's always a little bit more complex in practice. You might find that Trungile moves, she could actually even move away from her mom totally, although she probably won't. She could move up into the northern section of her territory. It's impossible for us to tell. My guess would be that Trungile, because we don't know exactly how that process works and how much of a role the daughters actually play in the choice as well. It might be that Trungile might decide to stay in an area that's very familiar to her, which would be south of the Gowrie Main and around Treehouse Dam. That's one of the areas that we've found Trungile in the most. Or it might be that she goes up further to the north into Buffleshoek, because with the death of Shaluva, there will be a little bit, well, I actually don't think the vacuum's going to last for too long. Do not catch a spider hunting wasp, little girl. That will be a mistake that you will not ever repeat. They sting hard. Look at her, she's so funny. She's so hot, and she's so tired. But she wants to just go back and carry on playing with her impala. To me, she looks more like Tundi than she looks like Karula, actually. What you seen? What have you seen? Oh, no. It's on the other side of the termite mound. Don't disappear, Trungile. Oh, Karula. A Karula is one of the leopards where, when I was first told that she had a wow, or the word wow on her forehead, I wasn't fully convinced. I thought it would have to take a little bit of a stretch of the imagination to see it. But when she looks straight at us like that, it really, I don't know, I can see the word wow very clearly between her eyes. Hosanna looks a bit more like Mom than Trungile does. Although since Shungile's eyes have gone a bit bluer, perhaps a bit more so. What have you seen? What's there, girl? She's looking at something. Oh, it's the impala. She's seen an impala. How's that intent gaze? From restful to fiercely concentrated. And the impala is aware. Unfortunately, I can't. If I reposition now, I'm going to make life very difficult. But to describe it to you, the impala is about 150 meters directly behind me. So she's looking just past the car at the impala. And the impala is aware of something, but I think it's actually more that it's aware of us. So it's just seeing what we're doing, but it hasn't actually seen the leopard. So I don't think this is the female that was looking for its baby earlier. I think it's a herd that stumbled through. It could be, though. It could be that female looking for its baby. She might have moved. It's not uncommon for grieving mothers, in terms of antelope or zebra to get killed themselves. It often happens that way. They're trying desperately to search for their offspring in the hope that they're alive still, and they get caught. It does happen. You can just see the wheels turning in Karula's head. The impala's moving off. Is she thinking about whether or not it's worth trying to hunt them? Or would she really rather just not be bothered? Are they just too far away? Leopards are opportunists, so if they were closer, if an impala herd stumbled through here in close enough proximity to her, she would go for it. She absolutely would. We've seen Tandi with 3 impala kills. Now, Jen B wants to know if perhaps Karula, in the spirit of Christmas, caught a lamb for each of them, and perhaps Hosana is with his. Maybe. I can't discount it as a possibility, but I doubt it. You don't really see cubs being given separate kills and then feeding on their own. At least we've never seen it, especially not with this particular family. What's always happened is Karula's made a kill, she's brought the cubs, and they've taken turns to feed. Sometimes she has made a kill, she's made 2 kills. We've seen that a few times, within relatively close proximity of each other, like, for example, the Dacre and then the Impala in the drainage line, excuse me, where Karula, they all stopped to feed on the Impala first, and then they went and all fed on the Dacre together. So I doubt it, Jen, but I can't discount it. I can't discount it as a possibility. She's so close to quarantine. Can't believe it. She must have been here the whole time. Blinking laconically at us. And welcome to Lucy again. Thank you for sending through your question, Lucy, or sending through another question. Lucy, you want to know how strong family ties are in the animal kingdom. Sorry, let's just see what this little monkey's up to. It depends on the animal. Family ties between elephants, particularly female elephants, are unbelievably strong, as are the family ties between lionesses. So female lions are strong and actually life-lasting. They are lifelong ties. Leopards, on the other hand, once they leave each other, they pretty much can take or leave each other, so to speak. In fact, they often, even females with their daughters, will growl at them. She's going to pop out now. She's coming up. There she goes. Where are you going? Karula, your cub's giving you grey hairs. Another, oh, she's after that tortoise. That poor tortoise. It thought it was making a lucky escape, but no such luck. Sharp-eyed Shungile has found it once again. What are you going to do with it, though, you silly thing? You can't do anything. I have a feeling if I go all the way around, she's going to lose interest and come all the way back here. And then I'm going to have to start again from scratch. So, Lucy, it depends very much on the animals. Some birds, for example, will mate for life. And some of them, their offspring will stick around for quite a few years to help them and to be raised by them. A jackal will live in family groups, so it is very much dependent on the different types of animals. A cheetah do things all by themselves. They're solitary animals for females, but for males they're in a group or a coalition, and that almost, in fact, invariably is a brother, is a group of brothers, or perhaps, where'd she go? She left the tortoise. Yeah, you'll have to get up earlier than that to sneak up on your mom, madam. Your brother's one thing, but your mom is a totally different story. She knows you're there. Bounce. Yeah, you've been well and truly spotted. Even I heard your approach that time. Oh. But family bonds for now, Lucy,
within leopards are a wonderful thing to see.
Yay! Yay, Impala! Mom, I love you, but also I really love this Impala that you got me. Thank you. Just imagine what a fantastic time those guests are having with these leopards. But yes, the bonds between a female leopard and her cubs are very, very strong. They have to be, because she has to leave them for days at a time and then come back and find them whenever she's caught them food. And they are, for the first few months of their lives, completely reliant upon her. Bonds between siblings are not as strong. Obviously, they make for useful play dates or play buddies while mom is away, and to practice pouncing and chasing and stalking. But once the leopards do go their separate ways, then there is very little in the way of connection anymore. With some limited exceptions, of course. She's still watching you can see in Krula's face, she's still watching the Impala. She's not committed to hunting them. She's just keeping an eye on where they are. In the meantime, Shungila, I don't think, has even noticed the Impala. I mean, apart from the one that she has in her mouth. Now where are you taking it? Did you do that just to spite James because he moved? You can see her claws, or you could see her dew claw sticking out of its sheath there, gripping the Impala. And that claw will be probably, of all of her claws, probably the most important of them. The dew claw, which is basically the animal equivalent of a thumb. Or the leopard equivalent of a thumb, or lion equivalent of a thumb. Any animal with a paw that has a dew claw. That is their strongest claw, and their biggest claw, and the muscle attachments are phenomenally powerful. And those are the claws that when a lion jumps onto the back of the buffalo, those are the claws that will grab onto it and hold it. Are you planning on eating your dinner anytime soon? Or is it just going to be playdate until it cools down? Luckily, Karula has the perfect hoisting tree. I doubt Shungila could get it up there, but Karula certainly can. And so the Impala birthing season, as joyful as it is for us to watch, is also a joyful time for the leopards and the wild dogs, particularly leopards and wild dogs, and cheetah. Go find your brother. Go fetch your brother and bring him back here. No? Okay. He's not far, by the way. When Brent found him on foot, he was probably about, I would say, 200 meters, 300. Let's call it 300 meters away from where we are now. So he's not too far away. Bear with me a moment, I'm just going to have a sip of my lukewarm water. I'm pretty sure I could put a tea bag in this bottle of water and have a cup of tea if I wanted. Shungile back on the hunt once again. Speaking of lukewarm water, it seems as though Byron apparently, I'm not sure if he's drinking some or if he has arrived at some. Let's go and find out.
And I wonder just how warm this water is. We're at Twin Dams at the moment. I thought we'd maybe have some animals around here, but there's nothing. Seems to be the trend for me this afternoon. I'm not sure. Maybe the animals are a bit upset with me for some reason, and they decided to ignore me. There's a kingfisher. Oh, two woodland kingfishers just landed in that tree
off to the side. That's always nice to see. A little bit lower, a little bit lower. There we go. Oh, wonderful. At least the birds still like me. I wonder if they've been bathing a little bit in the water, perhaps. Let's see if they do fly down. Oh, one just flew off completely. And there goes the other one. Well, nice to see the woodland kingfisher there. Kingfishers. Yo, it is boiling, everyone. I promise you, I can't tell you how hot it is. My shirt's sticking to my arm. It's I'm cooking here. I'm oh well. The joys of being in Africa. Africa's not for sissies, as they say. Africa's definitely not for sissies. Maybe they just don't make guides as tough as they used to. I don't know. Perhaps. Rebecca says that is definitely the answer. Maybe, actually, Rebecca, you broke up a little bit there. I don't hear what you said. It's amazing driving past areas and you can remember lion sightings or something that you've seen around in a specific area, leopard sighting, perhaps elephant sighting. I remember, it was not too long ago, about two and a half weeks ago, right here we had two big male lions from the Birmingham Coalition. And they were lying right next to us roaring. I'm not sure if some of you viewers remember that. What an incredible sighting. Amazing to have two big male lions roaring so close to you. And it's nice to remember some of the sightings that you had as you're driving around. I know working in an area before this, I remembered, you know, sightings of leopards in trees and all sorts, and driving around explaining and showing guests. It's nice you have those memories. Paul, you wanted to know what the female woodland kingfisher looks like. Almost exactly the same as the male. They're very, very, very little difference, if any. I'll just double check for you, but I don't think there's any sexual dimorphism between the male and female woodland kingfisher. Just make sure I don't drive off the road while I'm doing this. There we go. And there's no sign. There's adults. No, there's no difference, Paul. No difference at all between the male and female woodland kingfisher. It's just adults. They look almost identical. Oh, winter prism. Now you've asked an interesting question about the kingfishers and what qualifies a kingfisher to be a kingfisher, even if they don't eat fish. So I think it's obviously got to do with the flight pattern, beak structure, if you go into the finer details, foot structure, eyesight, all of that. And if you have a look, and I'll show you, they all look the same. And actually, this might be better if I go here. There we go, here are the kingfishers. I'll have a look at that. So if you have a look, they also fall under, let me just actually double check here, but look at that. And I'm also going to get my book out. It's a great question, and it's nice to have questions like that. It's high seen, or what is the word? Give me a second. I'll find that for you. I forgot. The word has evaded me now. There we go. Now, some of them have got a scientific name called halcyon. And I think those halcyon kingfishers are the ones that have got blue in them, blue on the wings, like the grey-headed kingfisher. Where is that? The woodland kingfisher, the grey-headed kingfisher, the mangrove kingfisher, all have quite a lot of blue in them. That's a halcyon. Fall under halcyon kingfishers, I believe. Then the pygmy kingfisher, I mean, is the smallest around, but their beak shape and structure is all exactly the same. And I think that's one of the main factors that make them kingfishers and put them into the category of kingfishers. You also have Alcedo kingfisher, also another scientific name, and that's the half-collared and the malachite, slightly different. And I think these are the ones that do try and catch little fish in that. Frogs, insects, so they generally around water more. The halcyon ones, I think, are the ones that do also feed on a lot more insects. But yeah, but it's mainly beak structure. All right, so we're going to continue cooking in the heat, and while I do that, let's head back to Jamie, get an update from her.
Well, certainly it does feel as though we are cooking in the heat, and I think Karula's got the right idea. She's plonked herself on the fallen tree that Shungile tried to hoist that impala kill into earlier. Unfortunately, it is almost time for us to leave the royal family. We're going to be leaving in the next minute or so. We just wanted to grab you back over here just to say a quick farewell to them. Quickly, let's go across Shungile before she moves. Oh, no, she's there. Well, you're going to actually eat your food, Shungile. Yeah, so we will be doing a fireside chat this evening. I know that the Wild Earth crew have, or the Wild Earth Twitter page, has put up an announcement about the fact that we will be having a special fireside chat on what is known as white muscle disease, which I can safely say Shungile does not have. She's absolutely alive and well. But we are going to have to start rushing across there to begin our setup. So we're going to have to say a farewell, a fond farewell, to Shungile, who is still playing with her dinner and having a marvelous time doing it. I'm so reluctant to leave. I don't want to drag myself away, but we have to. Okay, we must go. So bye-bye to Shungile and bye-bye to Karula. Hopefully, when we return here tomorrow morning, it will be to find the two of them in the area and the impala kill up in the top of the jackalberry tree. And we're going to be sending you over to Byron for the last few minutes of the sunset safari whilst we go and set up fireside chat, and we'll see you there.
Well, what a wonderful sight, you know, those leopards. I'm glad Jamie got to spend some time there with them and that you got to see them. It's always wonderful to be able to see, leopards interacting like that and to see them with that kill. And as I said, you know, it's all a learning curve for them. Just listen here for a second. Listen to all these cicadas. Very, very loud sound. Oh, I heard an interesting bird behind us. One that I haven't heard while I've been here. I'm trying to hear if it's going to call again. It's the Oh dear, I've been a blank now. Give me a second, I'll tell you what the name is now. I'll explain the call to you. Can you believe it? I've forgotten the name of that bird now. I think perhaps the heat has fried my brain a little bit. It's a somber green bull. That's what it is. Somber green bull. Thank goodness. Almost thought I was losing it there for a second. And it's got an interesting call, a wonderful call. I love hearing it. So it's described as Willie. When I come out to play, you're scared. But I promise you, it goes. That's exactly how the call sounds. Let's see if I can play it for you, and we'll see how close I am. Let's see. Let's see if I got close at all. So, somber green bull, beautiful, very well, it's not something that you would expect to see. Very plain looking bird. If you have a look at that, so one of the little browner birds that we get to see. Look at that. Somber green bull, but let's listen to the call quickly. And let's see, as I explained, I think I was pretty close. Let's see. There's more to the call. There we go, close enough. Do you hear that? Something like that. There we go, a somber green bull. And I just heard that, the first call we heard, just that. It's quite distinct, it's easy to identify, and I heard that calling behind us. Oh dear. At least the birds are still around for us. Because of this cloud cover now, it's become a lot darker, a lot earlier. So that's nice, makes a change. Might have to get the spotlight out a lot earlier. But it's still, you know, I often speak about it. It's that awkward light now where it's not quite dark enough for a spotlight. Also not that light that we can see as well anymore, but it's all right for now. We'll see what we can find. Try to see if we can't find a scorpion tonight again. Perhaps, who knows? Sorry, just give me a second. This spotlight seems to be hooked on something here. Robbie wants to know, what is my least favorite bird call? Wow, that's a tough question, Robbie. I've never been asked that before. Okay, VM has one. Hardy-da. Yeah, Hardy-da makes a loud noise. Do you want to give us a Hardy-da call, VM? Yeah, pretty close. They do make a lot of noise, and it's a loud screech, shrill. It's an interesting sound, and yeah, it's not a particularly nice call. So I might lean towards that with you, VM, but I don't know. I don't mind bird calls. Any bird call is nice for me. Oh, just saw a flicker of lightning in the distance off to the left. I really hope it storms tonight. Cool everything down. That would be wonderful. I wonder if we can find a chameleon. That would also be first prize. Trying our best. Oh, and it says it's going to be 5 degrees cooler tomorrow. So that takes us to about 32 degrees as opposed to 37, which means very little. Have a look. I just want to see if you can see some lightning in the distance there. Let's just keep an eye out in that area for a second. Let's see. There we go. It was a little flash there. But there's some beautiful lightning bolts flickering every now and then. There we go. There was an. Oh, I think yeah, maybe a little bit. There we go. Let's just have a look at from there. I think that should be good. Wow, there we go. That's a beautiful strike. You see that? So a lot of lightning in the distance. Yeah, I think that's the right area around there, Vim. But it's still very, very far away. Hopefully it does head this way. That would be great. Let's see. Come on, one more strike. One more beautiful strike for us. Just some flashes in the clouds at the back. Now, lightning photography is incredibly difficult. You need tripods and you need to set up the correct settings, and it's not easy at all. I do struggle with that at times. There we go, another one, and that's us. We're off. But nice to see lightning in the distance, but it is very far. I can hear the thunder kind of rolling in a little bit, but it's incredibly far. That's still, we don't have to worry about that for another few hours, that's for sure. Come on, let's see if we can find a scorpion. That's what I'm going to look for quickly for the next few minutes. It might not be dark enough just yet. Oh, green eyes. You've asked, do we get heat lightning in South Africa? Green eyes, I must admit, and I did geography at school, I've never heard of heat lightning. If you can maybe explain to me what it is. I've never heard of that before. I've never heard of that term. And as far as I know, the lightning that we've seen is by friction in the air with the clouds, and the moisture building up and the friction causes the lightning, the electricity, and then that's the lightning we get. I've never heard of anything known as heat lightning. That's interesting. So please do send it to us. Okay, so heat lightning is just the flashes of lightning occasionally in clouds really high up, and you don't have the follow-up of thunder afterwards. Okay, so is that what that's called? Yeah, we do get that indeed. At times you do get flashes of lightning in the clouds, and there was some of that back there. And only those really big flashes that we got, those lightning strikes, those lightning bolts, only those I think are the ones that give us thunder. But there were some other flashes around, and that's most likely the heat lightning that you're referring to. There was no sound to them. And yes, we do get that out here, definitely. There's not always thunder around. Well, you don't always hear the thunder. Yeah, so this obviously, the word thunder reminds you of a few songs. Mine would probably be Thunderstruck. Thunder! Na 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 na. Rebecca says, thunder only happens when it's raining. Now, I know some of you might be thinking I've got an incredible voice and I should probably sing rather than James. But James gets upset when I sing with him, so I won't do that. I'll leave the singing up to James. James actually hasn't played guitar or sung for us in a while, and I'm going to have a word with him, because it was always nice to hear James, and I'm not going to tell him this, obviously, but it's wonderful to get back and hear James strumming on his guitar and singing a song or two. I do think he is an incredible musician. I think he's amazingly talented. And I love his music. I love listening to him play. And there's nothing better. Some of my fondest memories when we still worked together was going into the Boma in the evening. And that's the area where people generally have dinner in some camps and lodges. Sit outside around the fire. Just a wonderful atmosphere. And then James would sit and play guitar for us and sing. And just absolutely incredible memories. Wonderful, wonderful time. Every now and then, a few of us that work together, there's a group of us, about six of us, five or six of us, and we do still try to get together at times. If James and I and the others are all in Johannesburg, perhaps, or if we're out in the bush together, and we do a little bit of that, which is great, great fun. Share stories and laugh, reminisce. No chameleons, oh dear. Or scorpions for that matter. Yeah. But it's too soon to panic. Come on, we need to find one. I can see the lightning in the corner of my eye. Thank you, Rebecca. You now have that song stuck in my head. I wonder if any of our viewers back home was singing along. Wow, now there's some serious lightning bolts going on in the distance. It's all a good sign. Hopefully some rain. Those birds came flying past us. All right, don't forget, everyone, fireside chat this evening with Jamie and Brent. And you can send in and watch and send in your white muscle disease questions. I think they've been preparing that for the last few days and some segments on it. So you can enjoy with them and watch that. Wow, sure, that is serious lightning. It's becoming a lot more frequent. It appears to be getting closer, slowly but surely, hopefully. Just have a look here for a second. Just scan, and I can actually see the rain, it looks like. I wanna know, have you ever seen the rain? Idea. I think the lack of animals and the heat has affected me. I do apologize, everyone. There you can see some of those flashes in the clouds at the top. But let's wait. I'm sure there's going to be one or two serious bolts of lightning fairly soon. Another flash. There we go. Wow. Yeah, that's definitely a lot closer. I love seeing the storms rolling in and the thunder and the lightning coming closer. It is one of my favorite things to watch out in nature, especially out in the bush. Yeah, you see that? That is beautiful. Might even hear some of the thunder. Rolling thunder. Wow! See that? That was incredible. Sure, but it's still very hot, very muggy.
And sometimes, you know, we do have these storms which build up, and it threatens, and it looks like a rain's on its way, and it misses us. So, not sure if that's going to hit us tonight, but I do hope so. Oh, there's a tree over here. It looked like some sign of elephant, perhaps. Excuse me. Okay. Scorpion time, come on. What have we got? Oh, I thought I had one. Not yet. So only a minute or two left before we cross over to Brent and Jamie for the fireside chat this evening. Would be nice to also spot a snake in the tree, perhaps. Anyway, from myself and Viam on camera this afternoon, hope you've enjoyed the afternoon. Great to see the leopards. We unfortunately didn't have too much luck, but it was still nice being out here. Thank you very much, everyone. We're going to cross over to Jamie and Brent for the fireside chat. Have a wonderful evening and or day wherever you are. We'll see you tomorrow. Goodbye, everyone.
Hello and welcome to the non-fireside chat. There's no need for a fire because it is hot as Hades in the tent.
It's melting.
Yes, we apologize for glowing, we're just sweating, but we're trying to be polite. But welcome to the Fireside Sunday night fireside chat. And of course I have James and Jamie.
Hello.
Hi.
And we're going to be discussing something that's taken up a lot of our mental capacity, and I know a lot of worry from all of you, and that was the Nkuhuma pride and the white muscle disease. So I was the unfortunate soul who happened to come across the first victim of the disease. We were following a male lion and a lioness as they ran down from the Rio Telapan into the drainage line, and Jandre was with me, and we just heard this painstaking ow. It was a cub call, but it just wasn't that normal, happy, healthy sound. And on further investigation, we found that poor little fellow down in the drainage line. And I mean, I was close to tears. It was really heart-wrenching. But I don't even want to talk about it. We're just going to show you what happened. So let's go have a look.
Just hang on a second. I'm hearing something very strange in front of me. This is one of the mothers. Very strange. Sounds like another lion cub. So, I mean, outwardly, I can't see anything wrong. It's lying in some mud.
One of the little Nkuhuma cubs we've come to love has been injured. We're not sure how she's been injured. Cubs calling forlornly. This is really, really heart-wrenching. But we must remember this is nature.
The second cub is definitely down now. Although we thought the first cub was with a broken back, it's probably more than likely disease.
Two or three cubs, possibly even four, seem to have gone down with a mysterious disease. That what we probably have here is something called white muscle disease or a variation thereof. Now, this is caused by a nutritional deficiency, often brought on by droughts. Now, it is not anthropogenic in effect, and I'm not sure what the veterinary treatment for something like that would be in a wild population of lions, and so the policy of non-interference will be applied.
Oh, these cubs are so playful. It's wonderful to see. Now, these little cubs have been struggling with a bit of a disease recently, and it was because of a bad drought that we had throughout the winter months here in Southern Africa, and they seem to have caught a bit of mange as well as a white muscle disease, and I think that's from malnutrition, not eating correctly. It does appear as if they're doing very, very well. All six cubs are here, so that is very good news for us. This is very, very special, everyone. I'm so glad you're... Wow! Gee! Oh, my... Oh, isn't this fantastic?
Well, there we go. And it looks like, fortunately for us, we only lost two of those incredible Nkulumas. And all of us spend so much time with them, and we are invested in them. So, Jamie, how did you feel? And well, you came up with a sort of very smart reason to why the vitamin E deficiency was.
Well, I've come up with a theory. I haven't come up with a theory. It's just something, my understanding of the way that vitamin E is absorbed, which is fat-based. So you can't absorb vitamin E without fat in your diet. It's the way that it's transported through the intestine membranes and into the lymph system. And my theory, and it's not confirmed by any of the medical officials, the vets or anything like that. I'm not a scientist, but my understanding of it is because their diet was so lacking in fat, because they were only eating buffalo and the buffalo just didn't have any, they were struggling to actually absorb vitamin E. And at one point, four cubs were missing. When Taylor was with them the one evening, there were only four cubs remaining. So it was such a vast, enormous relief when there were six. And not four remaining. And then the adults started showing symptoms, and there were times actually this last few weeks where we were genuinely a bit frightened that it was going to be utterly disastrous for the Nkulumas.
It was indeed, and I know, I mean, everyone here has got lots of opinion, and James, you also spent lots of time with them while they were there.
For me, there were three things about this whole thing that we've learned. Firstly, I think Jamie's correct. I think that thing about the fat is very interesting, because fat is a limiting nutrient in Africa. None of the ungulates out here develop huge amounts of fat. They don't get fat like sort of grain-fed cattle, which means there's never a lot of fat, which means that their fat is in the bone marrow. And in a drought, we know that animals, including human beings, will use the fat in their bone marrows to manufacture energy. So I think it's a brilliant thought from Jamie. The other thing, of course, is that it's selenium. Vitamin E is required for selenium. So on the other side of the fat issue, once the vitamin E is gone and can't be moved by the fat, selenium is missing. Now, selenium is a very important micronutrient that has a huge amount to do with immuno sort of response. And so without selenium, well, then there's already an enormous problem with disease. But for me, there were two other very interesting things. The first thing is that we all jump to conclusions all the time. And that goes for all of us. Absolutely all of us. Dare I say it, for some of you too. I mean, we all do it because we love to know what's going on. We theorize here. We throw out ideas, and we come to wild suppositions, some of which, and we have to do that because without that, great ideas wouldn't come around. But we do that, and let's acknowledge that. And secondly, how resilient these animals are. There were great calls from a huge number of people to put them down, put them out of their misery, wipe the pride out, take them all out and inoculate them, give them vitamin B shots and E shots and selenium shots. We lost two. That was very sad. But we've got the rest of them fine now, and their resilience is just, for me, quite astounding.
Absolutely, and I think on that theme, I mean, with the Styx cubs in the mange, and the fact that the Styx cubs, all eight of them, didn't make it. Yeah. One, admittedly, it was an elephant-related death, as far as they can tell. But all of the Nkulumas have kicked the mange. From what we've seen, they're recovering.
Yeah.
They look a bit scruffy, now, but other than that, they're healthy.
We've got a question from Polly, and I'm going to give this one to James. So with white muscle disease, does the death come from dehydration?
I don't know. I don't want to suppose after what I've just said. but what I will say to you is that it's possible, but that lion cubs don't often have to drink. You know, they get a huge amount of water from their suckling that they do with their mothers. Obviously, a lion that is immobile is not going to suckle. The mothers are not very good at lying there and making sure that they feed their cubs. So, yes, dehydration would have been a factor, I think. But I think the major factor, I mean, whatever's causing that paralysis in the back and in the muscles is eventually going to affect the heart probably, and the ability of the diaphragm to breathe in and out. It's a bit like a neurotoxic venom, I suppose. So I would suspect it's probably either heart attack or respiratory failure.
And especially with little cubs just going into shock.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's also true. And I mean, exposed to the elements, that one cub was sitting out in the sun and in the rain. So that hot and cold could also have done. Cold snaps kill animals really quickly. Mm. Okay, so we've got. Oh, sorry, I'm
not new.
James is this. This is my first time being king of the tent. So let me have a look there.
We're just looking at some questions now, everybody.
Jamie, Diane from Texas has been trying to read up on white muscle disease, and so I'm looking away. And it is very, very extremely rare in wild animals, and specifically in cats and lions. Have we ever heard of it being found in other lions or whatnot in the area?
I mean, Diane, if you did what we did, which was scour the internet for many articles on any kind of information about free-roaming lions with white muscle disease, you'll know as well as we do how rare it is. There was the reason that it was triggered, the question of it being white muscle disease, was actually the fact that, where were those lions in Mabat?
Mabat, so just
Mabat, just a little bit to the north of us, that they had white muscle disease or had just been showing symptoms of white muscle disease. And obviously, with wildlife vets around here, you don't just necessarily treat wildlife, you often end up treating cattle, because it's a deficiency, there we go, there's the word. It's a deficiency that's far more common in livestock than it is in wild animals. So this is a completely unusual situation, and that's what I think was made it so scary. We couldn't find out anything. We couldn't research, we didn't know what the survival rates were, we just didn't know what was going to happen.
And as with Lindsay's next question, you say, what causes the paralysis? We don't know. We don't know what causes it. I mean, to us, it looked like a broken vertebra. The animals went paralyzed from sort of where the thoracic spine joins the cervical spine. They went paralyzed. Oh, sorry, the lumbar spine, right at the back. Was that some kind of severing? Was it just a malfunctioning of the nerves?
As far as my understanding on some of the reading I did, it's basically very similar to muscular dystrophy. So the muscles start atrophying and almost disappearing. Mm. And so there's no muscle strength left.
It's a strength issue, it's not neurological.
No, it's not. But from what I read, it's amazing. From in domestic animals, it's literally boom, and within 2 hours, just that, I don't know.
Yeah.
but it works really quickly.
Yeah. And that's quite interesting, because we did with two or three, probably about a week before that, I remember looking at one or two of those cubs and saying they've got very fat bellies, but they look very hippie at the back. And they must obviously were getting that the dystrophy or atrophy of the muscles there.
I remember you saying that, and at the time we just looked over there going through that gangly teenage phase.
Yeah.
Oh. And anyway, Kathy, welcome to the fireside chat this Sunday evening. You wanted to know, we know which cubs were the ones that died? As far as I know, it were two of the ones from the youngest litter, from what I can tell. And the remaining surviving member was the one with the little female with the floppy ear. That's as far as I can tell, but I'm not 100% sure. I actually still haven't seen the Nkuhumas in a way that I can come. All the times I've encountered the Nkuhuma cubs, they've been asleep. Which is, it's great to see the clip of them playing. I mean, that cub pounce with Byron was just phenomenal. But I haven't had them, I've had them sleeping. So I'm not 100% sure, and I'm not 100% sure about what sex ratio we're left with for the cubs either.
I don't know either. I thought I saw another teddy yesterday, but I could well be wrong.
Oh, no, you could be absolutely right.
I just think that they're getting to such similar sizes that it's almost impossible to tell.
Another question we actually had quite a bit of out in drivers, why weren't Karula and Hosana and Shangile affected with the white muscle disease like the lions. Well, as you've said, Michael, it's a lot to do with their diet. So I think she has a much more varied diet. And you must remember, they also, when we're not with them, they're eating monitor lizards and squirrels. So she's got a much more varied diet. The buffalo were one of the hardest hit by that drought. So they utilized every ounce of fat they had just to stay alive. And also, you must remember, they're quite Catholic in their diet. They're after the grass. They will eat leaves sometimes, but their diet isn't very varied, and they've had to travel massive distances between water and grazing, whereas the leopard's diet has not only made up of buffalo, except if you're a very big male like Anderson, but it's been very varied, so I think they've managed to get the fat.
Mm. I would agree with that completely, and I think the buffalo were digesting their fat. Yeah, I mean, leopards are eating spiders and termites and fish sometimes, of course, a very good source of oil and selenium in many cases. So I think they're fine, and they certainly didn't ever look like that sort of gangly, miserable look at all.
They looked very happy throughout the drought.
They still look happy, everybody.
They looked so happy afternoon.
Especially because they saw the killer bees on foot. I think that made coolers.
I think it probably did, indeed.
Well, on that happy note,
very happy note.
Yeah, it's good. We're happy to say the Nkumas seem to be recovering. They are alive and well,
bouncing
about, and it's time for us to
say goodbye.
Say goodbye.
Yes. Goodbye, everybody. We will see you in the morning.
Yes. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye, guys. Bye-bye. Great to have you with us.
And it's 5 o'clock tomorrow morning. Don't be late.
5 o'clock tomorrow morning.
See you then. Hot enough, Brian.
Yes, very warm.